The basic problem for the whole of the Bonnie Prince Charles's cause in the 45 was a lack of popular support he received in Scotland above all. It is not always realised only 6 clans actually rallied to him, the rest either stayed passive or rallied to the government. And when he got down into England, it was much the same. Although there were plenty of Jacobite sympathisers in England, except at Manchester, there was no sign of real rallying to his cause. So it is that, the failure to really inspire a widespread movement, I think, made it impossible for him to win in the long term. Bonnie Prince Charlie, of course, inherited certain traits from his ancestors. Both Charles I and James II, for example, were absolutely pig-headed and stubborn as mules. And I think we have to say that Bonnie Prince Charlie was that as well at several times in this adventure. The other side of the coin is, of course, that the King George II was very popular at this period. He'd been the last King of England ever to serve on the battlefield at the Battle of Dettingen in 1743. He spoke English, which his father, George I, had never done. And there's no doubt he was a popular monarch. So once again, there was no appeal against an unpopular foreign ruler to be background for the Jacobite cause.
Charles and a handful of companions sailed in just 2 ships, but yet more ill luck followed in his wake. 100 miles west of Cornwall, they were intercepted by HMS Lion. In a 5-hour battle, the Lion and the larger of Charles's 2 ships, the Elizabeth, were reduced to little more than floating wrecks. The Elizabeth carried the bulk of the arms for the planned rising. As she limped back to a French harbour, the young pretender must have felt more exposed than ever. If his resolve was tested by the loss of the Elizabeth and her vital cargo, it was strained to breaking point by his reception in Scotland. Landing with only 7 companions at Arisaig on the west coast of Scotland, the prince did not give the appearance of a man about to lead a triumphant crusade. The clan chiefs had agreed to support a rising in the belief that they would be assisting an invasion by French regular troops. In fact, the prince had landed amongst them without a single French grenadier at his back. Now that it was obvious that the entire burden of the venture would fall upon the Highland clans, a number of the most influential chiefs wisely withdrew their support. A shrewder man might have abandoned the scheme at that point, but undaunted and with the flawed judgment which typified the House of Stuart, the young pretender soldiered on. Here at Glenfinnan, on the 19th of August 1745, his standard was raised, more in hope than expectation. Much against their better judgment, Cameron of Lochiel and the Macdonalds of Glengarry, Keppoch and Clanranald brought in their followers. The 45 had begun. Once raised, the small army marched on Edinburgh. As they marched southwards, additional numbers came in, and suddenly there was hope where there had been only uncertainty.
Moving up the hill here, over the hill. That's it, moving over, over the hill. Who will take the king's shilling and come and fight the young pretender and his rebel crew? Now then, don't be shy. Is there none brave enough to join the colours to defend the honour of His Majesty King George II? Huh? Step right up! Your country needs you! The young pretender and his rebel crew have come here to try and steal the crown from its rightful head. Take the shilling! And you can have the pleasure of kicking his Catholic arse all the way back to Rome! Is the nun brave enough? You, sir! Aren't you afraid of them papist dogs?
No!
Then aren't you man enough to defend your woman?
My woman can defend herself, and the Pope has more to fear from him than she from her.
Mind you, there's Episcopalians too. Who's brave enough to face them? I've got 1 shilling left.
I'll take your shilling.
Well said, sir. Here's your coin. Perhaps you'll be good enough to buy a thirsty young sergeant.
The arrival of the prince split Highland society in 2. Some took the king's shilling and joined the government army to resist the rebellion. But many Highlanders had joined the rebellion out of a strong sense of loyalty to the exiled Stuarts, while others had to be forced out in the order of the clan chiefs. The chiefs held feudal powers and were not averse to using their authority when the time arose. At first, the Jacobites could muster only some 1,200 men, but their support was growing. The commander of the British troops in Scotland, General Sir John Cope, therefore took a difficult decision. He had two choices. Either he could stand fast and defend the line of the Forth as the Duke of Argyll had done against the Jacobites in 1715, or he could march into the Highlands to nip the rebellion in the bud, as General Whiteman had done in 1719. The first option was out of the question. It meant abandoning most of Scotland to the Jacobites, and the rising might then take months to suppress. Cope therefore marched northwards, hoping to enlist the support of the Protestant Highland clans, who were sympathetic to the government. To his dismay, he found none of the pro-government clans were willing to support him. Although the vast majority of the Scottish population were opposed to the Jacobites, they were indifferent in the matter of actually taking up arms against them. So, with the Jacobites rapidly gaining strength, Cope was forced to turn aside rather than risk a battle. He therefore made for Aberdeen. With Cope out of the way, the road to the south now lay open, and the Jacobites raced southwards for Edinburgh, which they captured on the 17th of September. Edinburgh had once been known as the Geneva of the North, and one English observer, a member of the Privy Council named Stephen Poyntz, commented upon its fall with some astonishment. That a nation like Scotland, which makes a strict profession of the Protestant religion and values itself on respecting the sanctity of an oath, should suffer the pretender's son with a handful of rabble to walk the Protestant succession out of the kingdom without lifting up a single weapon or hand against him, is astonishing to the last degree and fills one with dreadful apprehensions for the behaviour of England. Had the town of Edinburgh made good the professions of their address, they might easily have destroyed such an undisciplined crew from the windows of their high stone houses. But how far it may now be in Sir John Cope's power to dislodge them, or how far it may be practicable for him with his handful of men to engage them now they are strengthened, I tremble to think. Relatively few of the Highlanders who occupied Edinburgh actually carried the basket-hilted broadswords or targes with which they are usually depicted. Broadswords were expensive, and generally speaking, only the Highland gentlemen in the front rank carried them. The first Jacobite forces were very makeshift in character. Patrick Crichton, an Edinburgh burgess, recalled the Jacobites whom he had seen during the occupation of Edinburgh. "I entered the town by the Bristow port, which I saw to my indignation in the keeping of these caterpillars. A boy stood with a rusty, drawn sword, and two fellows with things like guns of the 16th century sat on each side of the entry to the poorhouse, and these were catching the vermin from their lurking places about their pleads and throwing them away. I said to Mr. Jardine, Minister of Liberton, 'Are these the scoundrels who have surprised Edinburgh by treachery?' He answered, 'I had rather see it in the hands of Frenchmen, but the devil and the deep sea are both bad.' The officers, with their troops in rank and file, marched from the Parliament Close down to the Cross, and with their bagpipes and lousy crew, they made a large circle around it. I observed their arms. They were guns of different sizes, and some of enormous length, some with butts turned up like a herring's tail, some tied with pack thread to the stock, some without locks, and some matchlocks. Some had swords instead of guns. One or two had pitchforks, and some bits of scythes upon poles with a hook. Some old Lochaber axes." As the Jacobites settled down to the occupation of the capital, General Cope had meanwhile found enough shipping to take his army south by sea. He had hoped to retake Edinburgh, but instead his troops were surprised and routed by the Highland army in less than 10 minutes at the Battle of Prestonpans, early on the morning of the 21st of September, 1745. Scotland was now secure, and Charles's father was proclaimed James VIII of Scotland. But at this moment of triumph, the first signs of dissent began to appear in the ranks of the Highland Army. They had won Scotland for the Stuarts, and many felt they had discharged their obligation to the prince, and accordingly quit the ranks to head home. However, Charles Edward Stuart had his sights firmly set on the English throne as well. Still unsupported by French troops, he viewed his Highland Army as the only option for regaining that throne too. But even the prince himself must have suspected its unsuitability for the job. Nonetheless, the news of the easy victory at Preston Pan swelled the Jacobite ranks, and within a month, the Jacobite army mustered over 5,000 men. Against the express wishes of many of the Highland chiefs, on the 1st of November 1745, Edinburgh was abandoned, and the invasion of England began. The invasion progressed rapidly, and the Jacobites were soon in control of Manchester. The youthful Duke of Cumberland, with a substantial field army, tried to intercept the Jacobites near Lichfield, but they bypassed him, and by the 14th of December were at Derby, only 127 miles from London. Panic swept the capital, and there was a run on the Bank of England. The mood of desperation and spreading terror was captured by Hogarth in this famous scene. Londoners may have been terrified, but the French were delighted with the news from England. Hasty orders were given to mount a force to send across the Channel to assist the Jacobites. However, some French generals argued that the troops should go to Flanders to fight the British army there instead. Although some French regulars would ultimately be sent to help the Jacobites, they would not arrive for some time. While the French prevaricated, the Jacobite army halted at Derby. There, the young pretender and his officers argued for 2 days about what to do next. Charles was for pushing on to London, but the others disagreed. They pointed out that the French had still not landed, and that, crucially, there was no sign of real support from the English population. A rational man could see that they could not possibly hope to capture London, a city of 1 million inhabitants, with just 5,000 men. In the end, Charles had to accept their decision. But he evermore considered himself betrayed by the Highlanders, and increasingly relied upon his Irish quartermaster general, John William O'Sullivan, in preference to the Highland chiefs represented by Lord George Murray.
The problems of the Highland High Command really split down into two. First of all, there was the prince himself. Although he had a fairly high idea of his abilities, got totally from reading books, I might say, as a soldier. In fact, he'd never been on any active service at all in his life. He'd once attended, as a young teenager, a siege on the continent as a spectator, but he really believed that streak of Stuart stubbornness that he knew it all, and therefore he did not need all that much guidance. But the second problem, which compounded the first one, was the fact that his staff, if we can call it that, and his entourage, were divided into two warring parties, which were daggers drawn with one another. On the one side, there was Lord George Murray, who was by far the most able soldier in the Jacobite entourage. And then there was, of course, O'Sullivan, the famous quartermaster general of the army, who in the end Prince Charles decided to favour, because he talks more and more from Derby onwards about treachery, how he's being betrayed by both the English and, above all, the Scots, not rising in big enough numbers. So he tended to swing behind this rather inadequate person, who was not a good quartermaster general, never mind a strategist, who was, of course, an exile like he'd been himself. As Napoleon would say a generation and more later, better one bad general than two good ones. And this division of command, therefore, within the army of the Bonnie Prince Charlie, was a fatal complication.
With the fateful decision to turn north, although few could have known it, the Jacobites' cause had reached its high water mark. On the 6th of December, the army turned around and began retreating northwards. Still expecting the Jacobites to move on London, Cumberland had planned to fight them near Coventry, and he was taken completely by surprise by the sudden change of direction. So the Highland Army had almost reached Scotland before he managed to re-establish contact. But just as Cumberland reached the Jacobite forces, a false report of a French invasion sent him scurrying southwards towards London again. Unhindered for the moment, the Jacobites made for Glasgow and then laid siege to Stirling Castle. General Henry Hawley attempted to relieve the garrison, but he was defeated in a hard-fought battle outside Falkirk on the 17th of January. Despite the fact that it's normally regarded as a Jacobite victory, the Battle of Falkirk nonetheless gave the Jacobites something of a fright. While most of Hawley's army ran away, some government regiments, for the first time in the rebellion, stood firm against the Highlanders, who faltered in the face of their resistance. By now, a small contingent of French regulars had finally arrived in Scotland to assist the Jacobites, and it was this detachment which saw off the government troops and thus won the battle for Charles. Unfortunately, these were the only French troops to be sent to assist the 45. The French invasion had again been called off, and the Duke of Cumberland hurried north again to take over Hawley's defeated army. His arrival was received with great enthusiasm. In the name of his father, King George II, he set out to destroy the Jacobites once and for all. All of the predictions that the rising was bound to fail without French help were now coming true. Rather than risk another battle, the prince bowed to pressure from the Highland chiefs, and the Jacobites retreated northwards to Inverness. Cumberland pursued them slowly, halting for a month at Aberdeen. But on the 8th of April, he left the borough and within 6 days was at Nairn, only a few miles short of the Jacobite headquarters at Inverness.